Yeah, so good morning, Kat. So for today, we are going to discuss our topic two, and our topic two will be dealing with servers. And I know servers is not a new term to you. We'll be dealing with web servers. That is our topic two, or lesson two. And now, in this topic, you're supposed to have some objectives of what you're supposed to know by the end of this topic. You're supposed to define what is a web server. That is one of the objectives of this topic. You're supposed to define what is a web server. Still, you're supposed to explain the types of web servers. For example, you can have the application server, you can have the database server, you can have the file server, you can have the print server. So you're supposed to explain the various classifications of what of web servers. Still, you're supposed to explain the various web server problems, like the web server overload, web server routing. Still, you're supposed to explain the various errors caused by the web servers. For example, you can have a supported format. And lastly, you're supposed to explain the web server products in the market. So these are some of the objectives of the web servers. So we have just said this, I will explain the various web server products in the market. And what is a web server? Because a web server now, it is an application. In this application, it entails two things. It entails the software and the hardware. Because information is kept in a web server. So in case now, you require to access some information from the web server, used for the web browser. The work of the browser now, it is to connect to the web server and retrieve the information from the web server, the web browser, by using what we call the HTTP. So a web server is an application or a computer that responds to the HTTP request by returning the web result. So as we have said, for you to access the information stored in the web server, you must have a web browser. You can decide to use what we call a Mozilla Firefox, can use Google Chrome, you can use Internet Explorer, or you can use what Open Mini. That is what you call a web server. A combination of hardware and softwares that responds to what you call the HTTP request, the hypertext transfer protocol. That is what a web server. And the primary function of a web server is to deliver the web pages on the request of the client or the clients. That is the primary function of the web server. So we must have the client computers and we have what? The web server. And now for the information to be accessed using the browser, it has to be connected to the internet. That is what you call a web browser. Now, what is this client computer? Because you're seeing the client computer, it accesses the information from the web server. A client computer is that computer that logs onto the network and takes advantage of the resources in that network or internet. For example, you can have a client computer. For example, maybe you have some information stored in a ZTEX server, and now you want to access the information, or for example, you want to access your results. Once you log in, you become what? You become a client. That is what you call a client. I hope you have understood the difference between a client and a web server. Have you understood the difference between a client and a web server? Client, have you understood the difference between a client and a web server?
Yes.
Francisca? Yeah. What about Francisca? Have you understood the difference between a client? Yeah, that is good. What about Luz?
Yes.
Have you understood the difference between a client and a web server? Client, have you understood the difference? That is a web server. Now, what are the features or what are the characteristics of a web server? The characteristics or the attributes depicted by what? By these web servers. Now, one of the characteristics of a web server is what we call a large file support. We have large file support. The server is able to store information more than two terabytes. So it has what? A large memory. A large file support is able to store information more than two terabytes. That is one of the attributes about a web server. Large file support. It has a large memory. The next attribute of a web server is what you call the bandwidth routing. You have the bandwidth what routing. The thing, the second attribute is what you call the bandwidth routing. You have the bandwidth routing. So there is what you call the bandwidth what routing. The next routing. Attribute of a web server, the bandwidth is routing. So now, in the routing, now it is a process of controlling the number of requests a server can respond. For example, there is a way that the administrator can set that the server is supposed to respond to 1,000 requests. That is what combined with throttling. So limiting the speed of responses in order to avoid what? Saturating the network, or in order to prevent what you call the traffic. And this can be done by controlling the number of requests. The server is supposed to respond to 1,000 requests, maybe for 5 minutes. Because now, within the 5 minutes, and the number of requests, they exceed 1,000, it causes what we call the traffic. That's the second attribute of the web server. But with throttling, that attribute or that mechanism of request has to be stored within a specific period of time. Then another attribute is what you call the virtual hosting. We have what you call the virtual hosting. Now, for the virtual hosting, this is a method of hosting what for domain names on a computer using a single IP address. That method of hosting multiple domain names on a computer using a single IP address. And now, once you have the virtual hosting, it enables the machine to share the resources such as memory, processors, and other resources more efficiently. That is what the virtual hosting. That method of hosting multiple domains. The computer is using a single IP address. And you know what is an IP address. Because an IP address is a unique address that is able to distinguish any computer in a network. That is what you call the virtual hosting. You have said it allows the machine to share its resources, such as what the memory and host processor cycles. Then another attribute of the server is what you call the server-side scripting. You have the server side is called scripting. In this one now, it is used interface with databases. For example, we can have the current case, you can have written information. We must have a programming language in server side. For example, you can have PHP. The PHP acts as the medium between the web browser and what web server. The PHP codes that are used to retrieve information from the web server to the web browser. Still, the PHP codes can be used to boost information from HTML form to the host of the web server. This is what we call the server-side scripting. Any question on that point? Any question? Or any clarification? So these were some of the characteristics of the web server. Any question? Any question at that point?
No.
That is good. Now, we can discuss now the types of web servers. The types of what? Web servers. In one of the web servers is what you call the mail server. Yeah, the mail server. The types of web servers. The mail server. And now for these ones, they are used to move. A certain network, over a certain private network, you can use what called server 31. Okay. The whole website was the message. It is send emails or to receive emails about our corporate network. Between a client and the external server. So instead of retrieving the information directly from the web server, you retrieve the information from the host from the processor server. So it is between the client program and this client program, the web browser and host, the external server. And the purpose of the processor server, it is to filter request, improve performance, and share connection. So you have seen that processor server, instead of retrieving information from the external server or from the main server, the client of the program, that web browser, obtains the information from the host of the processor. So maybe I can server. Let me just see an image of the proxy server. I want to share an image of the proxy server. Let me just show you how it works, the proxy server. Are you able to see the proxy server? Can you see the proxy server here? Let me just see the proxy server, an image of the proxy server. Yeah, let me, it's loading. I want to share an image of the proxy server. It is loading. It's loading the proxy server. Yeah, are you able to see this image here? Are you able to see this image? We are having, let me just, can you see this image here? We're having the vent computer and we are having the proxy server in between together. So instead of this client accessing the information directly from them, from this right here, the information can be obtained from the whole, from the processor server. This is in between the client program and what the external server has. So have you seen it? It is in between the client computer and you have what the internet. Or still, you can have a client computer, we have what an external server. I hope you understood. So, Crash, have you understood the proxy server?
Yes.
Yeah, that is good. That is good. Another server is what you call, we have what you call the application server. We have what you call the application server. Now, the application server, they occupy a large chunk of computing territory between the database and the end user. And now, the purpose of the application server, it is used to connect what? The two devices. So an application server can connect what? A database server in the end user. This is like just an application. So, in this server, it provides an environment where applications can do what camera can learn. Understood? The purpose of the application server, it is to connect the database server and the end user. And still, it provides that platform whereby things can be done or where applications can do what camera can learn. That is what we call an application server. Then there is what you call the FTP servers. The FTP means what? The file transfer protocol. We have the FTP servers. And now we have the FTP protocol. And now for these servers now, they make it possible to move files from one computer to another computer for providing what we call file security and organization. In case now you want to transfer documents from this computer to this computer, and you want to enhance the security, you have to use what you call the FTP protocol. And now, in case of the FTP protocol, you must have what you call the FTP servers. They must be there. The file transfer protocol servers. Make it possible to move one file from one computer to another computer securely. These are what you call the FTP servers. Then, another type of server is what you call the collaboration servers. We have collaboration servers. Now, for these ones, they contain what you call the collaboration software. We have all collaboration servers. They contain what you call collaboration software. Now, these servers, they enable the end users. Remember, we are the end users. We are the people using these four service servers. They enable the end users to collaborate regardless of the location by using what they eat, the internet. So you can collaborate between two clients regardless of where you are. Someone can be in the US, someone can be in Turkey, and someone is in this country, but you can do what you can collaborate. But now, we must use internet, or we must use what you call a corporate internet in order for us to work together. So to collaborate now is to work together as a whole, as a team. Then we have called telnet servers. You have only connected was telnet servers. Now, a telnet is a boot logging in, or the boot log in. So internet now, it enables the users to log on to the host computer and perform tasks as if they were working on that remote computer itself. That is what we call a telnet. Server. It enables the users to log on the host computer as if they were there. That is what the telnet. Maybe I can demonstrate telnet now. Let me just have Francisca. Have you ever used the TeamViewer?
Yes.
Francisca, have you ever used the TeamViewer to connect to remote computer? Have you ever used the TeamViewer to connect to a remote computer?
No.
Because I want to demonstrate it now, because I have said it is a form of telnet whereby you can control a remote computer and see if you are working on that computer or that computer. That is telnet. Because I want to demonstrate telnet, that remote logging in. So, but have you ever used a TeamViewer? I will share my screen connecting to a remote computer. I'm saying my team is taking some time. Once it's about to connect, we shall connect remote to a different computer. So that was our thing. So we have server chat crew now, server. So we have to offer a better way of managing what being placed and have stage. You can offer interactive discussions, you can offer interactive chat group. These ones for these servers, they're supposed to be open to the public. Why? They deliver announcement, they deliver greater than also put advertising mechanism, also provide advertising mechanism. Then after the servers, there is what we call the secure server. We have a secure server, and now the purpose of the secure server is to manage the security protocols. It is to support and manage the secure protocols. For example, it is able to manage what we call SSL, the secure socket layer. Now, these servers, they encrypt messages. They both encrypt and host. They encrypt messages. So they're able to prevent that tampering by the management. Legitimate personnel. That is the work of the secure servers. It is the encrypt messages to prevent that interruption or that access by illegitimate personnel. For example, the hackers. Now we have a secure server and organization. There is no way the hackers can tackle that code, that information. Why? It's encrypted. And now we have to use a certain logo about this as one server. Then there is called the personal web server. And now for this web server, now it is used to hold or it is used to host a single web page or it is also a faster website. There is what you call the commerce. Web server. We have a commerce web server. For example, nowadays, people can buy items online, Jumia, you can put it from that we must have what you call the platform. So, this server, it contains a software that runs the main functions of an online shop. So, this product, ordering, and inventory management. And for this server to work, now, it must have what you call payment. So understood? Have you understood? So these were some of the web servers. Now I want to discuss what we call the web server overload. We have what we call the web, and even before we go to the web server overload, we can discuss some of the errors. You know what, in a web server, the error messages. For example, if you have seen the 500 internal error server, you can have the 500 internal error server. And whenever you see this error, the 500 internal error, it means what? This is a general message that is given whereby the message is what is suitable. So whenever you see the 500 server error, it is a general message that is given whereby no other message is suitable. That is what we call the 500 internal server error. Then there is what we call the 501 not supported error message. We have the 501 not supported, not implemented error message. The 501 not implemented error message. So whenever you see this error message, the server either does not recognize the request method or it lacks the ability to fulfill the request. And you can find one of this error. The 501 not implemented. The server either does not recognize the request method or it lacks the ability to fulfill the request. Have you ever encountered this error message? Clarine, have you ever encountered this message? Clarine, have you ever encountered this error message, the 541?
No.
Have you ever encountered this error message, Clarine?
No.
Because we are discussing the server. What about Francisca? Have you ever encountered this error message?
Yes.
What about Matthew? That is good. What about Matthew? Have you ever encountered this error message? The 500 internal server error. Matthew? That is good. He has ever encountered. What about Batty? Have you ever encountered this error message, Batty? So we have said, whenever you see this error message, the server is unable to fulfill the request. Then there's another error called the 502 bad gateway. We have this error message. We have the 502. This one. 542. We have this error message. The 502 bad gateway. So in this one, the server was acting as a gateway or a proxy. And received an invalid response from the upstream server. So the server was acting the server received an invalid response from the upstream. So we have the 543 service unavailable. So whenever you open a certain website and you realize they have this error message, the 543 service unavailable, sometimes that website is done for maintenance, or sometimes that website is overloaded with a lot of requests. That is what you call the 543 service unavailable. Maybe that website or the server is done for maintenance, or maybe that website is on temporary state. It has been switched down. That is what you call the 543 service unavailable. So let us proceed now. The next error is what we call the 504 gateway timeout. We have this error message, the 504 gateway timeout. the 504, we have this error message, we have this one. You can have the 504 gateway timeout. For this error, it acts as what you call the 502 bad gateway. But what happens now with this error now, the server was acting as a gateway or proxy. It did not receive a timely response. For example, maybe the server was supposed to respond that request within 2 minutes, but the server took 5 minutes. So you always get this error message, the 504 gateway timeout. The server was not able to respond that request in a timely manner. That's still an example. Maybe the server was supposed to respond this request within 5 minutes, but now it took 10 minutes. The client computer, the user, will get what? This error. Then you can have this error. The 505 HTTP version not supported. You can have this error. You can have that error. You can have this one. The 505 HTTP version not supported. The 505 HTTP version not supported. Now, who knows the meaning of that error? Whenever you see this error, party. Now, what is the meaning of this error? The 505 HTTP version not supported. The version not supported, party. Because you can just try to guess the meaning of that error message in a browser. The 505 HTTP version not supported. Party. But in the response, do you have any information about this error message? But and who knows about what about Guru? You have been silent. Now, what is the meaning of this message whenever you hear it, whenever you see it in a web browser? Ruth, Ibrahim, you have been too silent in this class. So, whenever you come across this message, the 505 HTTP version not supported, the server does not support the protocol version using the request. The server does not support the protocol version using the request. Yeah, because you have the versions of the HTTP, yeah, it does not support that version. Still, we can have this version, we can have another message. For example, we can have the 401 unauthorized. We can have this message, the 401 unauthorized. We can have this message. A query, that is correct. A query in Francisco, that is correct. That the server does not support HTTP protocol version. Query in your city means that the server does not support HTTP protocol. That is correct. Then you can have this message, the 401 unauthorized. You can have this message, the 401 unauthorized. You can have 401 and unauthorized. So whenever you see this error message, the server is looking for some encryption keys from the client. It is not getting it. That is what we call the 401 and unauthorized. The server is looking for some encryption keys from the client and it is not getting it. Or still sometimes, because you put a wrong password in the server, you always get this what error message. Because you put a wrong password in the server, you always get what this error message. Then you can have this one. I want Ogeba to answer this one. I want Ogeba to answer this one. Can have the 404 file not found. Can have this error message. The 404 file not found. Have this one. 404 file not found. Ogeba. Just give us the meaning of that error message, Ogeba. The 404 file not found. Yeah, the request being sent can be authenticated. That was for the previous what error message, the 401 and other list. What about now? We have this error message, the 404 for not found. Ogeba, the 404 for not found. I want to answer that. The meaning of that error message. The 404 for not found. correct. Remember, you have seen that the file has been deleted or moved. That is correct. Sir Francisca, that is correct. That the server cannot find the file. That is correct. Yeah, that is good. Yeah. Or you are correct. Everyone is correct. Even party that is correct. That the file being requested was not for. That is correct. That is what you call the 404. But not for. But not for. Sometimes when you get this error, the 408 request timeout can have this error. The 408 request can have this error message. The 408 request timeout. Whenever you see this message now, the client stopped the request before the server finished receiving it. That the client stopped the request before the server finished receiving it. For example, maybe you are downloading some information from the server, or you are retrieving some information from the server. And by bad luck, you make sure you delete, or not you delete, you cancel the request. Let's get this what? This is a message. You cancel what, that transaction, or you cancel what? That what you are initiated. Let's get the 408 requester came out. So these are some of the error messages. Still, there is what you call the bad file request. You can have this one, the bad file request. You can have the bad file request. So whenever you see this error message, the bad file request, the browser may not support the form or other coding you are trying to access. The bad file request, the browser may not support the form or other coding you are trying to access. Still, you can have an error message. For example, you can have the unable to locate the host. Unable to locate the host. So whenever you see this error message, unable to locate the host, the server is down, or the host is down, or sometimes there is no internet connection. That is what you call unable to locate host error message. The host is down, the server is down, or there is no internet connection. Still, you can have this error message. The file contains no data. You can have this error message. The file contains no data. You can have this error message. The file contains no data. You can have that error message. The file contains no data. So whenever you see this error message, the page is there, but it's displaying nothing. The file is there, but that page is displaying nothing. That is what you call the file contains no data error message. The page is there, but it is displaying nothing. And most of the times, this error is attributed to what you call the bad table formatting. Or sometimes, maybe the header information has been stripped. You always get this information. In case we have a bad table formatting, or the header information has been stripped. Still, you can have this in a message diffused by the server. You can have this in a message diffused by the server. Diffused by the server. Occurring. Well, just give us the meaning of this in a message diffused by the server. Diffused by the server. Diffused by the server occurring. Maybe just tell us. For the server. Still the server is busy. Robert Karin, I want to see that the meaning of that error message. Karin says she's seen that this is busy. What about Bati? Ibrahim, what is the meaning of that error message? If it's by the server, I want to see your response. Matthew, I want to see your response. I want to see your response. Matthew, concern that error message. Matthew? So Francisco, you are correct. Clarin, you are correct. The server is busy. That is the response. That what error may be. Maybe now the server is responding a lot of requests. And there is a lot of traffic. Ibrahim, no, Ibrahim. This is the server. still, you can have another message. For example, you can have what you call, maybe the connection diffused by the host. You can have this a message. Connection diffused by the host. You can have this a message. Connection diffused by the host. You can have that a message. Connection diffused by the host. Whenever you come across this in a message, connection diffused by the host, either you do not have the permission to access this site, or your password is incorrect. Connection diffused by the host. Either you do not have the permission to access this site, or your password is what is incorrect. You do not have the permission to access this site, or your password is incorrect. You can have what you call 403, access denied. You can have the 408 request timeout. You can have the failed DNS lookup. You can have the host unavailable. So these are some of the error messages. Any question in the error messages? Any other question? Any question in the error messages? So, Gila, any question in the server error?
Start.
Any question?
Yes, there is a question.
Yes.
I'm asking about
for one
unauthorized.
For one? Oh, unauthorized?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Is it the same with the connection refused by host? Is there a difference?
There's a difference. Sometimes, although they are almost similar, sometimes what happens in the 401 unauthorized. For example, if you're supposed to access a certain server, but now you're not the legitimate personnel. Either you're having a bad password. I think that so it is to give you that error message. You're not authorized to access all that information. Or in an organization can have to call the security levels. Can have what security levels. You are trying to access a security level above you. I think that.
Yes.
So you always get this message. You are not authorized to access all that information. And you have said still, maybe the server was looking for some encryption keys. Encryption information. In the case it does not get these keys, in the security perspective, to give that error message, the 401 and authorized. That is the 401.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, what about the other one? The other error message?
No, it's okay. I've understood the difference.
That is okay.
Mm-hmm.
So, any other question in the error messages? Francisca, any other question? Francisca, any question? Any question?
No, I don't have any question.
Yeah, because I want to be proceeded now. Any other question? There are messages before I go to the next section. Any other question? Yeah, that is. So maybe I can proceed now to the next subsection. So before I proceed, because now I want to discuss what you call the web server overload. Or what causes now the server to overload itself. But together, for example, you can have too much traffic, you can have the denial of service. So before I go to that now, maybe I can demonstrate now the telnet. Before I discuss what you call the web server overload. Let me just do the telnet before I go to that point. Let me just do the telnet now. Let me just say the telnet before I go to that subsection is a practical scenario. I want to connect to a remote computer. Let me just illustrate that. Even my network now. I want to connect to that. Just check. Now I've inputted the password of that remote computer using that is. Are you able to see that remote computer now? Can you see it? It's here. Now I'm able to log into that computer. I can even control it. Yeah, I can even control it. Are you able to see everyone? Yeah, Karan, are you able to see now that remote computer? But can you see that remote computer? That is good now. Now I'm able to log into that remote computer. I can even control it. Let me just log in. I'll be able to log in. And this is now I can even go to the start button. I can even just go to the start button. I access my computer. I just go to my computer. Now I'm able even to access the documents. This computer is a remote computer. Let me just open this local disk, and I'm using Telnet remote control. Now, for example, let me just open a document here. Let me just open, for example, let me just open the desktop of that computer. I can even delete that folder because you see it enables the user to access that remote computer. And see if it was in that physical location, you can even manipulate the information in that computer. I would configure the network of this computer. or configure the network of this computer. Just go to network. Network sharing center. Then I go to change the adapter settings. For example, maybe I want to change the IP address of this computer. Initially, it was using a dynamic IP address. I want to use a static or a manual IP address. Just go to the properties. Then we have that. Now, initially, if you look at this window here, initially it was using the automatic. I want to use the static. You just click this red button here. Then you can input now the new IP address. Then you just click OK. So I'm able to validate that IP address. Just click OK. So I've shared the IP address of that remote computer. Still, I can even switch off that computer.